decide what happens today. The deadline has lapsed, midnight. What happens today to those who have not surrendered?
As of midnight last night, Karen, we have been informed, or we were informed, that the number of PDLs or inmates who have surrendered voluntarily already match or almost match the original number included in the list that was posted by the Bureau of Corrections.
So are you saying it's 1,914?
Almost, okay. Yes. As of 11 o'clock last night, the total number was something like 1,707. That was as of 11 o'clock. But we are expecting that more PDLs would turn themselves in before midnight. And in fact, we were informed that some of them were in the custody of police officials already. So we estimate that the total original number of 1,900 plus might have already been much as of midnight last night. So having said that, I was informed that there remained a few PDLs in what we may call a gray zone or a gray area, where we cannot really determine, without looking at the records of their cases, whether they committed heinous crimes. So just to make sure that nobody's life or personal security would be endangered, this morning I requested the head of the Department of the Interior and Local Government, and also the head of the PNP, Secretary Anyo. I recommended to him that in the meantime that the Bucor is tallying the record, the count, and verifying the case records of those in the gray area, we requested that further law enforcement operations be suspended in the meantime.
I see. So that's big. So what you're saying is today you are asking, you've asked the DILG to order the PNP to first suspend, any capture of any additional PDLs or inmates.
That is correct, Karen. We want to make sure that those remaining are actually people who need to be arrested. So pending that verification, considering that the number who have surrendered almost match the original number of 1,900 plus, then we deem it safe and prudent not to pursue any coercive law enforcement action at this time, because we may unduly or unnecessarily endanger the life of not only the PDL, but even the law enforcement agents.
Okay, so no tracker teams should be sent out as of today?
Well, that's my request to the Secretary of the Department of the Interior and Local Government. It's up to him really to make the call, but that's my recommendation.
Okay, what happens now to President Duterte's announcement that he wants them dead or alive, alive captured with a 1 million peso price, preferably dead? What happens to this now?
Well, that is upon the assumption that these PDLs who are still out will have to be rearrested or recommitted. But since we're saying here now that those who have surrendered, maybe yun na yun eh, yung in the original 1,900. But the, as I said, merong few na medyo alanganin, ano? So we wanted to make sure before putting their names in the list, no, na talagang dapat silang maaresto. Pag merong doubt, we'd rather not include their name kasi baka mamaya, you know, even ordinary people may try to arrest them, and in the process magkaroon ng violence and somebody may get hurt.
Okay.
So we do not want that to happen unless we're very sure. We're not saying that we will not be coming up with another list at some future time. What we're just saying is at this time, we find it prudent to pause for a while, tally the count, make sure that those who have surrendered are those who are in the list, or those in the list, you know, something like tallying.
Okay.
But in the meantime, let's pause for a while. Let's not do any further coercive action.
Okay. Now, the 1,914, just for the record, that have been released since 1993, technically, that's roughly 200 PDLs a day on the average, were all convicted of heinous crimes. More have been released, technically, not from heinous crimes. My question is, the 1,900 plus who have come back and surrendered, Are they all convicted of heinous crimes, or some of them may have already earned their freedom and yet want to go back to jail for some reason? I mean, you have poverty, issues outside of Nubilibid prisons. Mm-hmm. They may not have something to go back to.
First of all, Karen,
what is the process?
All right. First of all, when these people return to the Bucor or any of its regional facilities, the first thing to be done is to verify whether they were in fact those PDLs who were improperly or prematurely released on account of good conduct time allowance. You know,
kung premature and improper.
Yes. Yeah, because it is our position that those who had been convicted of heinous crimes are not supposed to be to benefit from the additional or expanded good conduct time allowance.
So, after 2013, we'll discuss that later.
Yes, yeah, that's right. Anyway, that 1,900 plus pertain to those who were released after 2013,
but then,
not
okay,
before.
So what is the process? I'll give you a quick example before we go to is this all even legal? Is let's say you've been convicted of a heinous crime 1997. And yet you just chose to come back because you got confused with the announcement. Out of fear, you suddenly just surrendered. Or let's say it's 2005, you were convicted. And you've already done good conduct time. What have you ordered the Bucor to do? Because to keep them in jail an extra day is also is unjust.
I agree. So the very first thing that the Bucor would do is to recompute their good conduct time allowance. All right, so that will be the primary function of the Bucor once these PDLs come back. All right, so make a recomputation, try to find out whether are you included or excluded from the benefits of the 2013 GCTA law or not. All right, so but even those who were convicted before 2013 also we're supposed to gain good conduct time allowance under the revised penal code.
Yeah.
So it's just really a matter of recomputing. Now, if the Bucor, after a computation, finds out that, even without the benefit of the GCTA law of 2013, you have already served your sentence because of the good conduct time allowance under the revised penal code, then you are free to go to, you are now free.
Okay.
You will not be further incarcerated. It's really only those who were quite improperly or prematurely released who have to serve or who have to complete the remaining part of their sentence.
So you're announcing that that once they recompute, the Bucor has to set them free. My question is, who has the authority to decide that? Do they have to bring it up to the Justice Secretary first? The list of those they recomputed are valid GCTA beneficiaries and you approve it, or the warden, the Bucor director general can say, I've recomputed this, you have to go home.
Under the Bucor law, it's the chief of the Bucor, the director general of the Bucor, who has that power.
Okay.
Also, the chief of the BJMP.
So they don't have to go through
DILG.
You if they re-release.
Well, in the case of DILG, or rather BJMP, I do not have jurisdiction over them. They have to deal with the secretary, with Secretary Anyo in this case. But because of this department order that was issued in 2015, unless that department order has been repealed or revoked, which I don't intend to do, then all releases arising from a completion of sentence, whether full sentence or reduced by virtue of good conduct time allowance, will need a prior approval of the SOJ.
Okay.
But now, that's the release, not the grant of
the good conduct time allowance. Now, do you have some kind of a deadline? How you'd want the Bucor to approach the recalculation and the processing? Because what's even more unjust is if you're qualified already to be free and then and you didn't commit a heinous crime and then you're stuck in jail again for another year because the process is slow. Do you have a deadline?
Right now, we have not determined a specific deadline because we still want to see how it will go. We're still feeling our way through. But definitely, this is something that should be given top priority because, as you correctly pointed out, a day longer you know, for someone who is supposed to be free already, is rather unfair and unjust for him.
Okay.
So we'll try to determine the amount of time that will be needed to process all of this. If you will remember, the ombudsman suspended a number of officials of the Bucor involved in the grant of GCTA, and for that reason we are left with subordinates who will have to take over their place. So that is one constraint that we are facing right now.
Yeah, and for the record, we have to say that it is frankly phenomenal that close to 1,900 have voluntarily surrendered just based on the president's verbal order. So there is that's quite unique, and frankly speaking, it's never happened before.
Yes.
You'd expect an inmate to keep on hiding, and yet close to the number announced, they've surrendered.
Right. I find that phenomenal.
Yeah.
I myself was amazed. You know, normally a PDL in that situation would react in this way. It's not my fault if I was released. No, I acted in good faith. They told me that I could now go. So why should I come back? It's not my fault. So, but surprisingly, almost 1,900, those in the original list, although of course some surrendered for no reason whatsoever, not connected at all with the GCTA, and yet they chose to surrender.
So why do you think is it? Is it downright fear?
Well, there could be various reasons for that phenomenon. One is probably they're afraid for their life, because the president said, you better surrender, because otherwise you'll be hunted down, dead or alive, something like that. So maybe they fear for their lives. So I guess that's one primary reason. Number two, perhaps some of them might have really found it difficult adjusting outside. Maybe they don't have any relatives welcoming them, or they couldn't find a job anymore because they're quite old. They may actually feel that life inside is better because I'm assured of three meals a day, no matter how, you know, how small it may be. So maybe some people think along that way.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, right. Now let's discuss the controversial GCTA law. So you have a copy, I have a copy, and Senator Cheese Escudero, one of the authors, was here just a few days ago. Let's start first with the revocation. I'll start first coming from the president's order, the surrenderies. Section 5 of the GCTA law, which states Article 99 of the revised penal code, according to Senator Cheese, former Senator Cheese, this was not changed. It says that such allowances once granted shall not be revoked. In other words, it doesn't say if it was erroneously granted, if there was a mistake in granting it. It just says such allowances once granted shall not be revoked. Now, the order with the new IRR is after surrendering, if you were mistakenly granted, it will be revoked. Isn't that illegal? Let's start with that first, Secretary.
This particular sentence should not be interpreted literally.
Okay.
Yeah, because in the first place, if the grant of the good conduct time allowance was against the law, unlawful to begin with, because excluded yung PDL na yon from the benefit of expanded benefit, no? Mm-mm. But you nonetheless gave him that benefit. From a legal standpoint, your grant was invalid. All right, so you cannot invoke this particular provision that it cannot be revoked anymore. Okay. So what cannot be revoked anymore is if that good conduct time allowance was given validly, all right, by the proper authority to a person qualified. But if that does not meet those requirements, then it can be revoked. Because if it was invalidly given, it's a nullity. Mm-mm. All right, so you can revoke it because it didn't exist to begin with.
Mm-mm. Okay, to be fair, your point with Article 99 is it does say whenever lawfully justified.
Exactly.
So the director of the Bucor, the director of the BJMP, and the warden himself shall grant good allowances for good conduct and they cannot be revoked. But merong clause of whenever lawfully justified.
Yes, that okay. is the modifying phrase there.
So you can make that argument.
Yes, if it's not justified, then that can be revoked.
All right. Now, more controversial than Section 5 is the new IRR, which you have drafted along with other stakeholders. And we have the new IRR here. Is under the new IRR, essentially, the three salient points of the new IRR are if you are a recidivist, escapist, charged with a heinous crime, charged, you are excluded from the good conduct time allowance. That has not changed, correct?
Right.
Yeah. That is in Article 29. It's the first page, sir. Yes. That's Article 29 of the GCTA law, right? So you are in harmony. The new IRR is in harmony with that. Your second salient point is persons disqualified under the good conduct time allowance law, such as heinous crime convicts, but who were convicted before the law became effective in 2013, shall be entitled to good conduct time allowance. So you are in harmony with the Supreme Court.
Right.
That's clear. So you are saying it can be retroactive.
Yeah.
But this is where it's controversial. Your new IRR says if you were convicted after 2013, you've committed a heinous crime, you're convicted after 2013, you cannot avail of good conduct time allowance. And here, I wanted to ask you, sir, put it Section 3, that's Article 97. It says, which is Senator Cheese Escudero's point as one of the authors, the law says all convicts, convicts are not charged, all convicts are entitled to good conduct time allowance because the law is reformative and not punitive.
So in short, he's saying that a person like Mayor Sanchez would benefit.
In effect, if Mayor Sanchez did not break rules.
Yeah, on that assumption, he's eligible, he's qualified. So the rapists of the Chong sisters would be qualified as well for these additional benefits. Is that what he's saying?
Well, I'm not Senator Cheese, but based on the argument, no? I mean, he can call, he can give a reaction. But based on the argument, I would say it would be yes if they had really changed. And then if it's calculated, it would be correct. Go on, sir.
But, you know, there is a disqualification regardless. You know, if a person, a PDL, is disqualified to receive, we don't even have to bother about computation of good conduct time allowance. Why? Because you're not supposed to receive it. So why do we have to bother about your good conduct, evaluate your conduct on a monthly basis, when in fact you're not even entitled to it by provision of the law? So what he
if
is...
If you were charged, what you were saying, because if you're charged of a heinous crime, you can't avail it. So you're saying then on, you're disqualified.
No, what I'm saying here is yung Section 3, referring to convicted prisoners without making any reference whatsoever to the nature of the crime committed, that provision has to be related to Section 1.
Okay.
And there is a statement here in Section 1 which says, provided finally, towards the latter portion.
I have it.
Provided finally that recidivists, habitual delinquents, escapees, and persons charged with heinous crimes are excluded from the coverage of this act.
Okay.
All right. So on that basis, the logic will have to relate it to Section 3.
So you can't, what you're saying is you can't separate them.
Yes. We have to interpret the law as a whole. We cannot depend on one particular provision and literally interpret it in a particular manner. We have to harmonize all the provisions of a law so that we'll be able to get the intention or the spirit of that law. We cannot really just dwell on one particular provision. We have to relate it, interrelate all of these provisions. And if a person, like somebody charged with heinous crime, is disqualified from availing of these benefits, how much more if he is already convicted?
Okay, but then the author said that the idea of that provided finally recidivist habitual delinquents charged with heinous crimes are excluded from the act are for those detained but not yet convicted. Because if a trial is going on, you can stay in prison for, frankly, a year. So what they're referring to is it's the detention factor that's not included.
But that is not what the law says. You know, if that was their intention, they would have stated it more clearly. Mm-mm-mm. That all of these four groups of PDLs would not be entitled to the benefit of preventive imprisonment only. But they worded it in such a way that all of these four classes of PDLs are excluded from the benefits of the entire law, not only that particular provision.
And you think this will stand in the Supreme Court?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
So, but I hope somebody brings it up because, you know, this law, admitted even by the lawmakers themselves, have some ambiguity. The mere fact that two people are interpreting it differently is already a manifestation about the ambiguity.
Okay.
Because if there is no ambiguity, there is no room for interpretation.
No. So, Secretary, if that's the argument with the new IRR, wasn't the Supreme Court decision already clear in even making the benefit of the Good Conduct Time Allowance law retroactive? Because it will always, in effect, as Senator Chi said, coming from the Supreme Court decision, it will always side beneficially to the accused. In other words, Dilima wanted it prospective nga eh, that only those who committed the crime after 2013 can avail of GCTA. And yet the Supreme Court said, no, that's prejudicial.
Correct.
If it is in favor of an accused, then you'd have to go retroactive, which frankly was quite surprising to me as well. But you're talking about, if that's how the Supreme Court made that decision, then isn't it the same argument the Supreme Court may say, Secretary Guevarra, your IRR is prejudicial to those after 2013. Why would you say that those before 2013 can avail and not after?
Because in this particular case, if you committed the crime after 2013, then this law will apply to you already. And this law says that if you committed the heinous crime, you will not benefit from this law.
Mm-mm.
So if the crime was committed after 2013, this will apply to him.
Yeah, but then Article 29 of the revised penal code is from the 1932 Constitution. So that is not a new law. Article 97, where all convicts, is also from the 1932 Constitution. Also, this Article 99 is 1932. So in other words, isn't that probably why the Supreme Court decided it's retroactive? Because the 2013 law did not change the 1932 versions of Article 29, 97, and 99.
So, well, anyway, the essence of the Supreme Court decision...
In other words, that's an old law.
Yeah, is to make the benefits of this new law, the additional benefits, we're talking about the additional benefits here, applicable also to those who were convicted prior to 2013. Anything that will be beneficial to an accused or to a detained person, a prisoner, can be applied retroactively, and that is based on the law itself.
All right?
But here, we're talking about a situation where a crime is committed after the effectivity of this law. So if there is any question as to the validity or legality of this law, then the proper petition will have to be filed in court.
Okay.
But this is how the law is worded. So
okay.
That's it.
Reaction to human rights lawyer Attorney Olalia, who said the new IRR changes the law and it violates the clause of equal protection. It's prejudice to those who deserve the GCTA, and the SC has already upheld the equal protection clause. And this goes against the very idea of reformative justice. So your reaction to that, because he does make a strong point to a degree that what happened, yes, we are angry at Sanchez, he didn't deserve it, but what happens if you're a poor man Okay, heinous crime, nakapatay ka, nakarape ka, mm-hmm. you've served 20, 30 years, nagbago ka sa loob, naging pastor ka, nagturo ka, mm-hmm. tumulong ka pa. Mm-hmm. Does that mean kung ikaw ay na-convict ng January 2, 2013, there is no way for you to have good conduct time allowance?
This law became effective, I think, sometime in May.
Okay.
Of 2013. So, going by your hypothetical example. Alright, okay. So, he will still be entitled to good mm-hmm. conduct time allowance.
Eh, kunyari June.
Under the revised penal code. Smaller time allowances.
Okay.
Yeah.
Smaller time allowances, which you're saying he can still earn his freedom.
Yes, alright. So, he will continue to have that kind of good conduct time allowance. So the only thing that will not apply to him really will be the additional benefits.
Okay, because in the last IRR, mm-hmm. if you're in the last IRR, the good conduct time allowance calculation, some say, was very big mm-hmm. to the point that it can slash off 19 years of a 40-year jail term if you've served 25 years. Mm-hmm. So it's that big. But now, it can slash 19 years, but under your new IRR, how have you recalculated it?
We have not made a calculation, based on an actual example.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, but you correctly pointed out mm-mm. that if this 2013 law is applied to the fullest, then I guess more than half of someone's sentence will be cut off.
Yeah.
Especially in the case of the special time allowance for loyalty, mm-mm. where, for example, there was a calamity, a typhoon or an earthquake, and you had an opportunity to escape, all right, but you did not escape, so you get a loyalty mm-hmm. award for that, a time credit for that, which is 2/5 of your sentence. Imagine if there were two consecutive calamities na where the jail or the prison was destroyed and you had an opportunity to get out, to escape, but you did not. So two occasions only, 4/5 of your sentence will be out.
So that's too big. That's too big.
Too big. So but that's legislative policy.
Uh-oh.
I'm just commenting.
Yeah.
So if they think that they might have miscalculated, made it too liberal, then it's up for them to mm-hmm. amend the law.
You would want that amended. Because Senator Chi said he wanted a uniform 15 days but lost. It went up to as high as the list I have is 30 days.
30 days a month of good conduct time allowance. So for me personally, I think that's pretty high. What I want is a balance, a certain type of a good balance between rehabilitative justice and also a certain degree of punitive justice.
Uh-oh.
So that we enforce discipline as well.
Okay, mm-hmm. So when would you do this? Because, it's quite interesting. I have the list. Mm-hmm. First 2 years of imprisonment, that's 20 days.
20 days.
The minute you hit third to fifth year, it goes up to 23. Mm-hmm. 6th to 10th year, that's 25. 11 years is 30 days. And then if you study, teach, or mentor, that's an additional 15 days.
A month.
If you were to recommend an amendment, do you need an amendment to this? This can, or can an IRR do it alone?
No. So an IRR cannot do that. It's got to be an amendment of the law itself.
So you cannot.
We cannot do that. We cannot do that. I know for a fact that so many bills have been filed as a result of these issues that crop up. So I guess some of these bills would recommend a lower mm-hmm. amount of good conduct time allowance.
Okay, if you say you don't have, you can't do that legally, then how could you make the distinction between everybody convicted after 2013 and before? Because based on the Supreme Court, mm-hmm. everybody has essentially the same number of deductions, regardless what year you were convicted. Di ba ganun yun?
No, hindi. Yung retroactive, all right, so that means to say the crime was committed prior to 2013.
Oh, this would be also the calculation.
Yes, Pero yung mga after 2013, a crime has been committed, no? After 2013, eh, maliwanag yung sinasabi dito sa section 1 eh. Mm-hmm. Oh, so this will apply to you. This will not be prejudicial to you if the crime was committed after 2013. Because the governing law is this one, enacted in 2013. Mm-hmm. And ganun ang pagkakasabi, no? Mm-hmm. You are excluded together with recidivist, mm-hmm. escapist, habitual delinquents. Mm-hmm. So if that was not the intent, mm-hmm. of the lawmakers, mm-mm. they should do something about it.
Okay, so,
but that's how we interpret it, because that is what appears in section 1, and we interrelate the whole thing, provision by provision.
So Senator Bato, when he was BU Court Chief, I had him here, mm-hmm. said, wag kaming sisihin nyo yung batas, nakasulat sa batas, all convicts can benefit. He said that on Headstart. Uh-huh. And so he said, isang drug-related crime, mm-hmm. he actually researched and looked at all those that were released under his stint for 6 months. Mm-hmm. He said one heinous crime convict drugs was released during his time, mm-hmm. and the others, merong heinous crime, but the others, hindi heinous crime. Mm-hmm. But Bato said, that's the calculation, what can I do? Mm-hmm. And then he did not go through your office, mm-hmm. right? He did not follow department order, is it 153? Parang, my memory serves me right. Something like that. Was Bato wrong?
Well, he followed the practice of interpreting the provisions of the law in that manner of mm-hmm. his predecessors, meaning interpret section 3 as if there were no mm-hmm. distinctions as to the nature of the crime committed. So mm-hmm. I cannot really fault him mm-hmm. for that.
Because but it was wrong.
Well, from my point of view, that was an incorrect application of the law, because our interpretation is radically different. Mm-hmm. In fairness to Senator Bato, mm-hmm. During his stint as
BU Court Chief,
he was probably made aware about the existence of Department Order 953, which required an approval by the Secretary of Justice on the matter of releasing PDLs who had been convicted of reclusion perpetua, yeah. or life imprisonment. He wrote a letter to us and then requesting just to, you know, facilitate in order not to to consume much time, because a person is about to be released already, if that matter could be delegated or restored mm-hmm. back to the DG, to the BU Court Chief, no? Yeah. instead of going up all yeah. the way to the Department of Justice.
But you did not respond.
There was no action on that part, on that matter,
on your end,
by the DOJ.
Paano yun? If that's the case, then should Bato have acted on his own?
Well, I think he gave the interpretation or the argument that the law itself does not require that it pass through the Secretary of Justice.
Because it was just a department order.
Right. I think he gave that kind of argument, and that's a valid argument also.
Okay. Thank you for watching. For more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.